And there we go. Okay, this is going to be a test. First, let me just, without the teleprompter, let me just welcome you to the show, welcome you to my space. Yes, I do need to lose a few ounces. Luckily, we have a tie that sort of covers it up, or maybe it accentuates my belly fat. I have no freaking idea. I got myself.
It's a new baggage. And the new baggage is for the new lights. But you can't see the lights because you're not supposed to. You see the light shining.
Anyway, thanks. So yeah, welcome to the green screen. Welcome to the frickin' green screen. I spit. I hope you can't see that, but I don't know. These lights are pretty good. I just want to welcome you. This is my channel. Most of you guys know I do voiceovers. VoiceTube, hello. Kind of sounds cool, although you can't see me knocking on that because of the frame thingy. This is kind of wild. This is the story. This is the story of a man named Ari. Okay, what happened? That was very corny. What happened is I've always had a love to do on-camera work. I love on-camera work. That's where I started in this business back in the late 70s. Actually, it's funny, my father, who became an actor, as well as myself, caught the bug because we both had a friend, a client of my dad's, who's also a stockbroker. He was a stock-breaking actor. And this guy named Andy caught the bug. He never really ended up pursuing it, but I mean, as far as in the long run, but my father and I both forged ahead, and I ended up first trying out for on-camera, not even knowing what voiceover was. And in the late 80s, it was my pop who turned me on to a class and said, I'll pay for it, go. And don't come home until you can do the non-announcer announcer. And so I never came home. I'm still, actually, that's how I make my living, is by going, and having a microphone. But no, I just started doing voiceovers. And what happened was the voiceovers kind of started winning over the on-camera. I was doing both and making my living doing both. But the thing is, the voiceover with the internet, when right around 2000, really, is when things started to snap and pop for me. I was able to start booking things throughout the United States. It was basically the monster had grown, and Godzilla was roaming the country with a microphone. And so I ended up, you're going to see, this is my life story, my career story anyway. So, and around 2000 is really, 1997, I moved back from Dallas phase one, where I was dabbling in both acting and voiceover. I had started in the 80s, and maybe even in the late 70s, really, doing a lot of extra work in the 80s, early 80s. Then I stopped doing extra work and buying and selling electronic equipment in the mid 80s, selling it at swap meets. And that was making myself a better living than I was when I was just trying to dabble in acting. And as I became a better actor and a better voice artist, I lived here and continued to pursue that. Upgraded my demos and so on and so forth. Then I moved back to Los Angeles in 95. Now, having kind of lived on credit cards a little bit, they know about it. But luckily, I didn't have to file for bankruptcy. We settled, was able to make enough money to help pay everything off. So I'm going to edit that part out. In any event, you notice I just edited there so I can kind of keep this a little shorter. I moved back to LA in 95, and between 95, really 97, and 2000, the internet, as a force for good, and good voiceovers, and it was allowing people, anybody who, at that point, 97 through 2000 was really the, I don't know if the word crucible is the right word, but it was certainly the setting for those who were willing to really push the internet to its boundaries as far as having a home studio and sending out auditions and good quality sounding audio through the internet, which at that time we were still dealing with 56K, had gone from 28K modem to 56K. That's not 56 megabits. That's not even 5.6 megabits. That's 56K bytes. In other words, very, very slow, for those of you who don't even know what that is. Look it up. And anyway, the internet was starting to... Now, I think broadband had come in the late 90s, it to almost every, you know, it was affordable for almost everybody. I think first mainly big companies had it. And I just started calling, doing a lot of calling and emailing almost every day, just trying to let people know I exist, sending them to my websites to listen to my demos. And it was starting to work. I was starting to gain traction. I also bought a box that allowed me to do voiceovers using my basically a device in my home studio that would allow me to send my voice through the ether, through the not really the internet, it's through a special phone line using a similar protocol to the internet. It's streaming data, and it allows me to actually, and I still have it, speak here and be recorded there in basically close to CD quality audio, which allows my client to basically have control over the recording, as opposed to hoping I send them a good file and crossing their fingers. If it's a big client, big companies, so on and so forth, they like to have the ISDN. It's called Integrated Services Digital Network. That and the internet were was a driving force to my dropping the on-camera work, probably right around 2000, not far after 2000. I didn't even pursue, I don't think I even went on many auditions, very few auditions, for commercials mostly. And just basically, I was starting to be successful in voiceovers, so that's what I did. And through like 95 through 2010, or 2000 through 2010, for about 10 years, I started gaining so many clients outside of Los Angeles, I was able to, I was basically able to move my whole business wherever I wanted to live, wherever I was, that had internet access, and I could, and also ISDN access, the digital device. So I found this place in Dallas. This is my living room. You're seeing my living room. I have this green screen, which I'm still trying to figure out. I've done it before when I was in LA, actually. There's a way, it's called Chroma Key. A lot of you watching are going, like rolling your eyes, like, Ari, you just have to go click, 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 and you have it. I know I'm really close. But in any event, so now you're just seeing green. Unless I take this video and somehow figure out a way of putting a nice beach behind me or a bedroom or something like that. Maybe a living room wall. Wouldn't that be groundbreaking? So my love for on-camera has been there all along. And one of the things I thought of, I tried this with paper back about almost 10 years. It's 2013, so it was like, yeah, right around 2003. Yeah, right around there. Maybe a little later, 2005. So I had an email come in and said, do you do on-camera work? Do you have a green screen? We need people who can record corporate content at home and send it and, you know, with the green screen. I guess they were going to put the image on later, or they wanted me to put the image. It never got anywhere because I tried it, and I didn't have good lighting at that point. I didn't have any good lights at all. And this is a start. These are two. Well, let me get to the story of how this all happened. Why did I buy this teleprompter and this camera? I have the iPhone being held by on a tripod with a little thingy, and then the green screen. Actually, I bought about 3 months ago, and it just sat here in the living room, and it's been in my living room. This has been my living room wall for about 3 months. It really reminds me. It's been calling to me. And basically what I did is just sort of sat, and I'll get the lights eventually. Things have not been as lucrative or remunerative as they had been a couple of years ago. So feeling the punch of a low of a reduced economy. So what I did, why do I have all this now? And why so fast, within like 3 weeks, I got an iPad, finally popped my iPad cherry, I'm not using it right now, but I'm looking at it, and I will in a moment. I got this iPad, it's basically a teleprompter device, or whatever you want to call it. You stick the iPad in there, which is really the main guts of it. And then it has like this two-way mirror, so I can see the text, but you won't see the text. You'll just see me, hopefully. And then, unless the camera's not rolling. And then I got all this stuff. Okay, what happened is, strange thing. A voiceover client, here it pays to say, I said, hey, Juan, I got the check. Thank you very much, because I did this thing for a guy in Miami. and he speaks very little English. That's not the Spanish accent. That's more like a Czechoslovakian or something. But anyway, this guy has hired me for voiceovers. And we did run about a month and a half ago, and he sent me the check. And I said, hey, just want to let you know I got the check. Thank you very much. Just don't always do that, but I did it. And he wrote me back almost immediately saying, rather than saying, oh, good, I'm glad you got the check or whatever, this was the acknowledgement. He said, find this link here to this Vimeo video. Can you do this? And his English is not that good. I thought he wanted a voiceover of what the guy was saying. It was a little test video of only about 30 seconds or even less. About 30 seconds. And he was talking about, it was a corporate thing. It was a guy, and he walks in front of, probably is a green screen, pretty good, and there was like a corporate thing behind him or something, and he talks about with this, I think he had a Spanish accent. It wasn't Juan, but this gentleman, he's an actor, and he speaks, but it's in English, but with a real bad, like a real rough accent, I should say. And it was just about 30 seconds long, and I transcribed it, was going to do a voiceover, and I wrote it back, and I said, I had a funny feeling. I said, Do you just want the voice on this? And he goes, no, I want to see, do you have the setup to do on camera? And I went, wow, this is the little bird flying through the window or flying into the house and going, it's time, you know? And I told him, I said, well, I'm thinking of I have a green screen, and I'm actually thinking of getting all the equipment. Let me put it together a little short demo. So what I did is I didn't have the teleprompter, didn't have the iPad yet. I just took a piece of paper and I typed it out in real big letters, and I had a look like a cue card, and I had just the lights here in the house, and I opened the window, it was during the day, sent him a little video. He said, you sound good, let me know, you know, if you get the equipment. We found somebody in Miami, because I said, well, I'd have to fly there because I don't really have the equipment to do it here. And I thought to myself, wow, that could have been enough to pay for everything if I booked that job potentially. I said, you know, bing, and then it was the same day or the next day, out of the blue, somebody says, I saw your profile in LinkedIn and see that you're an on-camera actor. It was similar to the thing 10 or so years ago. We have content that comes in. Do you have a setup with a green screen? Crazy. I said, all right, that's it. And luckily, things started picking up and some checks started coming in, and there's always like a little buffer of credit cardness if you have to, but I always like to pay those down. And I went onto Craigslist and I got I found an iPad. I got it for $175, which was a very good deal. It was a first generation, no camera or anything, and no Retina display. But it has 3G if I want to hook up AT&T and all that. And then I ended up getting two 500-watt lights. One of them is, the barn door is slightly damaged, and the back is a little damaged. It got in a little bit of an accident, but they're both work fine with stands. And then I have two more stands with these lights, these, you know, sockets where I can put more light just with the regular bulbs, or I can get some floods. And then maybe I could fill up these shadows here. Got the iPad thing, got the thing for the iPhone. It's just a few bucks, but it's a little thing that screws onto a tripod. And then I got the tripod, a second. I already had this tripod that the iPad's on, the teleprompter. But behind that is a smaller tripod I got for like 12 bucks. It was like real cheapy from China or something. Very cheapy, light little, but that's all you need for the iPhone. So I got that in back of it. And this wireless microphone setup, the most important thing, the most expensive thing. And this is a G3, and it was actually a microphone, wireless microphone setup that was actually used in a fairly famous YouTuber's videos. And this guy, I think he upgraded to maybe even a more expensive one, although this is great. I still don't know exactly why he sold this, but anyway, it's a G3 wireless. He's probably watching this going, dude, don't talk about my thing like that. And I go, no, I won't talk about your thing at all. No, but basically, this is a wireless microphone setup. It's one of the best. It's what Ed Bassmaster uses. This guy is Andrew Hales, L-A-H-W-F, LAHF is his channel. And he told me which ones he used it in, the one where Like we ask people for their food. He goes into a restaurant and asks them if he can have some of their food. And crazy stuff. And I like a lot of his stuff. It's pretty cool. But I actually, and then these are autographed. I don't know if you can. Yeah, I don't know if you can see that. A.H., Andrew Hales. I mean, I'm kind of a fan, so it's like, wow. And I got a good deal. I won't say how much, but I got a pretty good deal on eBay on these. I outbid everybody else and luckily won. And that was the main, this was the heart of it. Once this arrived and it worked, it was like, I was off to the races and got the lights and finished up the iPad thing and just did all that within a week. Because this was, once I had this, and I bid and lost so many auctions, because these go for a lot of money. That's basically it. All right, actually, that's the story of my life. Now, I don't know whether there's even any time left. I'm going to first check to see if it's still recording. Yeah, it sure is. It's going to be a long file. Let's just give this a try. Hey guys, welcome. My name's Ari. I'm going to go ahead and tell you about something I learned about, and I want to kind of share with you. And it's something that might be able to really help your company out. And if things are sort of a little rocky, it might kind of make it a little make things a little smoother. Now, your company keeps a lot of valuable data, right? Customer lists, personnel files, financial reports, confidential documents. And there are a lot of employees with access to that data. So how can you be sure that they're acting in your best interest? Now, you could go all hard-nosed cop, show, detective on everyone. But, you know, that can cause a lot of resentment. And it could actually grind your company to a halt. Now, luckily, there's an easy way to monitor employees and catch problems before they arise. Introducing Spectre 360, the revolutionary employee monitoring software that alerts you to potential problems before any harm is done. Now, unlike like a security camera, Spectre 360 doesn't just record employee activity. It proactively searches for suspicious behavior across all company servers, computers, even mobile devices. So, well, if an employee, let's say, copies a sensitive file to a USB drive and then uploads a client list to the cloud or visits inappropriate websites, you'll be notified in no time with a comprehensive report detailing exactly what happened. So it can actually kind of nip problems in the bud. Now, there's no hours of spent looking through backups or data logs and needle in a haystack kind of stuff. You know, Spectre 360 actually puts you in front of the problem, whether it's fraud, productivity, even harassment. So you can deal with it immediately, minimizing any impact and improving your organization's efficiency. So stop looking for that needle in a haystack and go to Spectre360.com for a free trial and see the whole picture today. Spectre 360. Stay one step ahead. Thanks for your time. I appreciate that. And now a duck. Yes, that is a duck timer.